Good morning. Welcome to St. Charles Borromeo. With our deepest sympathy, we welcome the Dowling family, friends, neighbors, and any parishioners who are here today in person or on our live stream, as we gather for this liturgy to celebrate the life of Patricia. May her soul rest in peace. Amen. To help preserve the sacredness of our worship space, we ask that you please silence your cell phones and any other electronic devices that you may have brought with you today. Thank you. And we will soon begin our Mass, but before then, let us now take a moment to stand and prepare by silently reflecting on the resurrection of Christ, which God gives us today. Please stand.
Thank you. Good morning. Indeed, it is a good morning, and it's always a good morning because God always has a way forward for us. Even in these times, in times when we lose our beloved ones. I am Kwame Asenyo, and I'm the pastor of St. Charles Borromeo Catholic Church, and I welcome all of you to this celebration, a celebration not of the death of our beloved one, but to celebrate the life. Short as it may look in our eyes, we gather together, we come together to celebrate the life of Patricia, Claire, Dowling. We are here to thank God that though short in our eyes, we had the opportunity to relate with this soul, to interact with this soul, and she has impacted our lives, her life, her personality, and everything that she had. She affected each and every one of us in a good way, and that is why we are here. Our presence here is a testimony of the fact that 66 years, short but effective. Effective instrument of God's work on us and for us. So we are here to thank God for that. And so I welcome you, Brian, and your family to this place, to St. Charles Borromeo Catholic Church, where Patricia had worshiped also with us. And we're here to celebrate the Eucharist, which she herself was very, very close to. And we pray that our prayers may be heard by God, and that Patricia will pray for all of us. So let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I now bless the cremains of Patricia with holy water. This holy water recalls her baptism. And about that baptism, St. Paul tells us that all of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death. And by baptism into his death, we were buried with him, so that just as he was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Because St. Paul says, if we die with Christ, we shall rise with Christ. Let us now bow our heads and pray. O God, in you all sinners find mercy, and all the saints find their joy. We pray to you for our sister, our beloved Patricia, whose cremains we honor today with Christian service, that she may be delivered from the bonds of death. Admit her to the joyful company of all your saints, and raise her on the last day as you promised, to rejoice in your presence forever. And we make this prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. We will now listen to the word of God to console us.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the just are in the hands of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seem, in their view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are in peace. For in the eyes of men, indeed, they be punished, yet in their hope, full of immortality. chastised a little, they will be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in a furnace, he proved them, and as a sacrificial offering, he took them to himself. Those who trust in him shall understand the truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect. The word of the Lord.
A reading from a letter of Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we who were baptized in Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too may live in newness of life. For if we have grown into union with him through a death like his, we shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that our sinful body might be done away with, that we might no longer be in slavery to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you.
And with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you also may be with me. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know the Father, and you have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also believe in the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated. We have a very beautiful gospel reading today to accompany what we are doing now. We need to understand what we are doing here so that we can give in our all, give our all to it, our strength, our mind, our conscience, our actions, our bodies. Everything must be engaged in doing what we are here for, so that it can help us, it will help us to put in perspective, because what has happened to us is real. The reality is that we have lost someone. We have lost someone. And Yes, we can talk about all the, oh, no, she's in a better place. Yeah, we know she's in a better place. But still, we have lost someone. And we are going to feel it in our lives. A hole has been created in our hearts, in our lives. And long after we are all gone, we are going, in all our own ways, we are going to experience that void. We will try to reach out to Patricia, but cannot. We will try to do it, but we will realize that she is not there. And so I say, this is why we gather in the church. This is why we come to do what we are doing right now, because what we are doing right now gives us that perspective, gives us another way to look for Patricia and find her and be able to talk to her. Even though she is not here physically, we will have a way of communicating with her. Our faith makes it possible for us to talk with one another, because our faith tells us, our faith already tells us, when you come associate with us and begin to learn what we believe, when we hand it over to you, if you come to know what our faith is, you come to find that human beings are not only bodies. We are not just this. We are more than this. And we have to make sure that anybody who relates with us should not be relating with us only on the physical level. They should find who we are. They should find something more than that. They should find our spiritual selves and be able to relate with that one too, so that at moments like this, when we lose this one, when we lose the physical, they can continue to talk with us. Our friendship do not break because of shedding this body, which we will all go through, brothers and sisters. Patricia is just reminding us. Patricia is an example. One more, let's take it as one more message that Patricia is giving to each and every one of us. When she was with us in physicals, her physicals, she gave her life to us. She related with us. She advised us. She contributed to our conversation. She contributed her mind, her opinion. Let this celebration be one last advice from Patricia, by her transitioning, she is speaking again. And what she is saying is what we just read, what we just heard from the readings. She got it from there. Jesus says, you have faith in God, or you believe in God, believe also in me. Well, why is that necessary? I mean, if you believe in God, shouldn't that be enough? Full stop. I believe in God. That should be full stop. That should be everything. That should be enough. There's no need of believing in something else anymore. But Jesus says, you believe in God, believe also in me. Now, why that is very important is that believe in God, faith in God, you can say, I believe in God, and no one is going to challenge you on that. Because scientifically, believe in God, that's not verifiable. There's no way we can check that. None of us have seen God before, you know. So there's no way nobody's going to really compare and say, okay, I'm going to check whether you believe in God. What am I going to use to do that, to measure your belief in God? That's unmeasurable. No one has any instrument to measure that. But if you say, I believe in Jesus Christ, I can do something about that. At least some of us who have read the Bible, I can. Jesus' lifestyle and his teachings are in the scriptures. I can take some of them and what Jesus did, what Jesus actually did, his life. He's hanging on the cross. I can use that and find out whether you are ready to give your life to hang on a cross, on the crosses that the world gives us. I can use something like that to measure, to challenge you, to find out whether you really believe in Jesus Christ. So Jesus wants us to actually make sure that what we believe is really a concrete thing, to bring it into life, to bring it into our interpersonal relationships. And that, when I read the obituary, when I read the story of this beautiful woman, the story that I read, that was the line that caught my attention. There's one line in there that caught my attention. That line is that everyone who came to relate, to talk to this woman, left feeling good about themselves and about the world. Everyone who encountered her left feeling that life is worth living. You know, that's we have only a few people in the world who do this, who are like that. Yes, there's some of us, I mean, and don't come to me, I'm culprit number one. That you talk to and you talk to these people and you leave like you feel like going to hang yourself. This is something that is happening in the world, that people have dedicated themselves who are just natural peacemakers. That everywhere they go, you see people coming to bond, not scattering. That people feel good about themselves. That is the primary goal of Jesus. That's the mission of Jesus himself. Jesus' mission on this world is to make human beings look at one another and love one another and bring one another together and see the good in one another and drive that and make that their subject so that those people feel good about them, their humanity, whoever they are, black, blue, green, yellow, wherever they come from, whatever they love, how their lives, that they may feel good about their humanity. That's the line that I think that it's the best line in the entire life of Patricia. And I am not proclaiming her saint. But saints are not people. Saints are not people who never did wrong. Saints are not people who never did wrong. A lot of the saints, they were worse sinners. We're the worst ones. Oh, don't get me started. I start talking about Saint Augustine. You don't want to hear it. But he is the bedrock of Roman Catholic theology. St. Augustine. St. Augustine knew all the women in his time. He knew all of them. Okay. To the point that his mother, Monica, will always sit in front of his door and guard in the door, waiting for who gets inside that room. Okay. So you don't want to get me started. So saints are not about that. Saints doesn't mean that they didn't never committed or they were perfect. No one has ever died perfect in this world. No one is dying perfect. No one will ever die perfect. Perfection, God grants that. God looks at that and gives us that. It's a gift that God gives us at the end. But important thing is that people who strive always, when they fail, just do it again. Start again. Try it again. Try it again. Try it again. Try it again. There's always room. As long as you're breathing, there's always room for improvement. That's the saint. The saint is the one, we have heard that in a song that someone sang. It said, we fall down, but we get up. We fall down, but we get up. We fall down, but we get up. For the saint is just a sinner who fell down and got up. You do not abandon yourself to the ground, but always seeking to make people's life feel good. And for that reason, we come. That's just one small thing that I'm mentioning here. We come to celebrate this woman's life. 66 years is short in human eyes because, of course, we want her to be here 200 years. Okay? So that's fine. We can continue to desire to have her physical presence. But that means, for me, 66 years in this world means a whole lot of years in heaven. Because it's the same life. As I told you from the beginning, we are not just bodies. We have spirits too. And the spirit and the body lives together. But it's the same life. And when we shed this life, this one, the spirit continues. That life continues. And so she is there. Jesus says, if you don't believe in me, if you don't believe in me, believe the works that I do. Believe the things, my life, the things that I do. The generosity, the kindness, the faithfulness, the peace making, the hunger and thirsting for righteousness, just to do good. I'm just looking for the opportunity to do good. If I can find it, if I've done all the good in my home, I'm taking it outside. I'm going to look for it. Look for more good. That is a life that will never die. A life that continues, starts from here, yes, starts from this world, in your marriage and everything, in school and ballet and everything. It starts from here. But it continues. It will never die, even when this body dies. And therefore, Brian and the family, I ask you to continue. And Liz, you said something about you talk, even when she was here, you talk to her as if you're talking to God. That's what you said. Now is the time to even do that more. Because now she is in God. And now you will be talking to her really as you're talking to God. Let us continue to relate with her. Let our belief in the communion of saints, that we communicate with the saints, we do. Death does not take that away. So I encourage you, I pray for you, that you will be able to talk to the spiritual Patricia. Relate with her. She will be real in your life because her works are still with you. May God bless you. God bless all of you who are here, that you may be able to continue your life, but inspired by the life of Patricia. Amen.
Amen. We, the parishioners of St. Charles Borromeo Church, we remember our beloved dead, family, friends, relatives, acquaintances. We remember them. And in the Catholic tradition, the month of November is set aside for particularly remembering our deceased. And if you come to St. Charles in November, you'd find little altar cedars around the church. And we invite people to bring pictures of the deceased. And we pray for them, especially during the month of November. We have a book of remembrance, so I'm going to have Brian come over now and enroll Patricia in our book of remembrance.
Now I invite Julia and Andrew to come to the amble and lead us in prayer. Let us all stand. God, the Almighty Father, raised Jesus Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask God to save all people, living and dead. Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
Patricia, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that she be now admitted to the company of the saints. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Patricia, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that she may be raised up on the last day. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of Patricia, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of raising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O God, you are our shelter, you are our strength. You listen in love to the cry of all your people. Hear the prayers which we offer for all our departed sisters, brothers, and friends. Cleanse them of their faults and grant them the fullness of your redemption. We ask all these things through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
In the morning when I rise,
Let us stand together. Let us continue to pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to the Almighty God. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. O Lord, look favorably on our offerings so that your departed servant Patricia may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ, who is our Lord. In him, the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful people, Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for us in Jesus Christ in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, and without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy.
O Lord, you are indeed holy, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, as we give thanks that you have held us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We humbly pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, O Lord, your church, spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity and justice, together with Francis, our Pope, Michael, our Bishop, and all leaders of the world. Remember your servant, Patricia, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who was united with your son in a death like his, may also be with him in his resurrection. Remember all our other brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your presence. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may be coerced to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through Christ, your Son. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Now let us pray using the words that Jesus Christ has offered us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your followers, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," do not look on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Let us share with one another the peace and the consolation of the Lord. Brothers and sisters and friends, this is the Lamb of God. This is Jesus who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are we who are invited to share in this banquet of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be. May the body and blood of Christ bring us to everlasting life. Amen. It's now time for communion. We invite all of you who are Catholics and have made your first communion to come to communion. If you are not coming because you're not Catholic, you can also come and cross your hands this way and we'll give you a blessing. You can also stay in your pews and continue to join us to sing and praise God for the life of Patricia. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let us now invite Kevin to the Ambo to share with us some memories.
Good morning. Excuse my back, please. On behalf of the Dowling family and Pat's extended family, thank you all for being here today. I'm Kevin Dowling, Brian's brother. I've known Pat for almost 45 years, most of our adult lives. She's been my sister-in-law and my friend. I know we're all struggling. Pat's illness and passing happened so quickly, and we're all trying to deal with the shock and our grief. Yet we gather here today as a community that loved her and appreciated her to honor her memory and acknowledge the positive impact she had on so many. This morning, I'd like to offer up first my thoughts and observations about Pat and her life. Then I'd like to share some comments Brian has about the support and love that he, Liz, and Claire have received from you all during the past few weeks. There were so many wonderful dimensions to Pat. I want to focus on three of those dimensions. First, she was a creative person with an orientation towards the arts. She was also a dedicated and accomplished teacher. Lastly, and importantly, she had a deep caring for people and a real focus on family. Let me touch briefly on all three. Before I met Pat, she had an illustrious career as a ballerina. She studied and performed in the San Francisco Ballet and then received a Ford Foundation scholarship to study at the National Academy of Dance in Illinois. As we all know, the ballet world is highly competitive, requires deep concentration and a lot of talent, and Pat thrived in this environment. She worked with Lou Christensen, the founder of the San Francisco Ballet, and Anatoly Vilsack, the great Russian ballet teacher. When I recently saw some photos of Pat as a ballerina, I was struck by her composure as a young woman, the physicality of this type of dance, and the self-discipline required to rise to the top. Later in Pat's life, her creativity and artistic bent strongly reemerged in her focus on painting. She set up a studio in the back of their home and became quite prolific. Her paintings were vibrant and colorful, reflecting her positive attitude towards life. She posted a lot of her paintings on Instagram and later started offering her work for sale at a local arts fair. She also worked with a children's book author on a new book illustration. Pat's career and her vocation was as a teacher. For almost 40 years, she taught high school literature. It was her passion to share her love of literature and the power of books with her students. She developed a deep knowledge of literature, especially about Shakespeare and American writers, including African-American literature. I was always amazed that she had the patience and dedication to teach teenagers, not that I have anything against teenagers, for that many years. She would tell me that her classes often had up to 40 students in each class with multiple sections per day. I have to believe that somewhere in those classes she had students that were as challenging as my friends and I were in high school. Pat was highly respected by her students and her teaching peers. She influenced thousands of young people over the years as a teacher, and that was immensely gratifying to her. As her teaching career progressed, she also developed an innovative film study curriculum that helped students understand movies as an art form. Her knowledge of film and her ability to make this topic of study come to life for her students as an intellectual discipline was noteworthy. Pat's most important legacy was her focus on family. She and Brian had a very strong relationship and marriage. They brought two wonderful, intelligent, and beautiful young women into the world with Liz and Claire. And in partnership with Brian, who, by the way, hit the jackpot when he married Pat, she was a devoted parent. Very importantly, she was a tremendous mother who was highly supportive and very caring. She provided her daughters with ongoing tenderness, love, and understanding. And she was a very close friend and confidant to Liz and Claire, and she was a major influence in their lives. This love and caring extended to her broader family as a daughter-in-law, sister-in-law, and aunt. She always brought a lot of love and energy to her family relationships. And from my vantage point, and I'm sure you all share this perspective, Pat made the world a better place. Let me move to some comments on behalf of Brian, Liz, and Claire. First, they want to thank you all for the support and love you provided during this challenging time. Brian said to me recently that the outpouring of kindness and help has reaffirmed their belief in humanity. As we know, we live in challenging times, and the media at least would like us to believe we are very polarized. Yet Brian's view is that he and his daughters have experienced a profound level of sympathy and connection from friends and family. Brian also wants to relay his deep gratitude to Liz and Claire for their compassionate and very capable care they provided their mother. They engaged with the medical community and spoke their language. They were both optimistic and realistic. And together with Brian, they worked to figure out the best daily care plan and adjust to new information. Importantly, they helped their father deal with his devastating situation and the stream of bad news while experiencing their own emotions. They have been and continue to be strong and tenacious. They embody Pat's values and her courage. While we're all experiencing a tremendous amount of grief from losing someone that we love so deeply, I would like to suggest that we take today as an opportunity to step back and think about the very positive impact Pat had on the world. As we have gathered here today together, I encourage us to embrace our personal memories of Pat, focus on our love for her, and to truly celebrate her life. Thank you.
On behalf of St. Charles Borromeo Catholic Church, and on my own behalf, we would like to thank all our friends, family, and acquaintances of our dear beloved Patricia. I'd like to thank you especially because you showed up to celebrate with the family her life. And I want to assure you that this is not the end. This is actually the beginning. This is the beginning of taking account of your life with Patricia. Now you have to tell that story. You have to tell that story, your life, your physical life with her is over, but your spiritual life with her continues. So now is the time to be able to codify that physical life. Tell that story. That 66 years has many of you in it. And so continue to tell the stories and the memories, just like Kevin has started for us, let us continue to tell Pat's story so that Pat will never die, will always live in those stories. Thank you for coming. We would like to thank, acknowledge all our ministers, our music ministers, and our guest pianist who gave us this wonderful meditation song. Thank you. Thank you. We'd like to acknowledge our coordinators of funerals in our parish. We have Brian and Michael, and our tech audio-visual technician, Jim Oliver. Thank you all for serving and helping us celebrate this wonderful life that God has blessed us with. In our Roman Catholic Church, we throw in this little ritual at the end of the Mass where we incense the cremains in honoring. These are the cremains that Pat used to channel God's love to all of us. And so we want to honor that and thank God for that. So let us now rise and commend Pat into God's hand. Before we go our separate ways, let us now take leave of our sister Patricia. May our farewell express our affection for her. May our farewell also ease our sadness and strengthen our hope that one day we shall joyfully greet Patricia again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Now I invite everyone here, lift up your hands towards the cremains as we bid farewell to our beloved Patricia. Into your hands, O God of mercies, we commend our sister Patricia in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for all the blessings which you bestowed upon Pat in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and our fellowship with all the saints in Christ. O merciful God, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant Patricia and help us who remain in this world to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with Patricia forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless and console you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.